Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and the page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box. For the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Now let us go to the first article of the day. Now this news article is about the bilateral meeting between India and China, that is between Indian Prime Minister and Chinese President in the sidelines of the SCO summit. Now this news article will be relevant in prelims syllabus under current events of international importance and national importance, and in main syllabus in GS paper 2 under India and its neighborhood relations, bilateral groupings and agreements involving India and affecting India's interests, and effect of policies and politics of developing countries on India's interests. Now the news tells that Indian Prime Minister and Chinese President has met yesterday, that is 13th June 2019, at the capital of Kyrgyzstan, that is in Bishkek. Now this bilateral meeting has happened in the sidelines of the summit of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Now recently we learned that India has planned to have bilateral meetings with three countries. One is Russia, one is China, and other is Uzbekistan. That day during the news analysis, we saw that we have been receiving several requests from various other countries as well, so as to have a bilateral meeting with Indian Prime Minister. So as of now, the bilateral meeting with the China and India and Russia have completed. So in this meeting, the meeting between India and China, both the leaders have agreed to have a dialogue on India-China boundary issue. This is to arrive at a fair solution. Both the leaders have asked the special representatives of India and China on the boundary question. So there are special representatives of India and China on the boundary question. So they have to meet and carry forward the discussion. And they were also asked to expedite or quicken the border discussion so that a fair, reasonable and a mutually acceptable solution is arrived soon. Now to assess, you know, to have some opinion about how the bilateral interaction was between India and China, according to Indian Foreign Secretary, this meeting or this interaction was substantive or meaningful in content. The leaders discussed about the status of bilateral relationship after the informal Wuhan summit. Now this Wuhan summit happened between India and China in 2018 in the month of April. Now this was the first informal summit between India and China, and very importantly, this informal summit was happened at a time when India-China bilateral relations were very tense because of more than 70 days standoff in Doklam. Now Doklam standoff was between the armies of India and China at the Doklam plateau. Now, this plateau lies at a tri-junction between India, China and Bhutan. To be very clear, this place Doklam is in the territory of Bhutan. The Foreign Secretary of India has also stated that the Chinese President has confirmed that he will be visiting India this year, will discuss all issues from a strategic and long-term perspective. Also, both the leaders agreed that the approach with respect to border issue should be constructive. Here, the Chinese President has highlighted the need for regional cooperation and connectivity. He has told that the Bangladesh-China-India-Myanmar economic corridor is an example for expanding the India-China ties, and that India and China have entered a new phase of relationship after the Wuhan informal summit. So the overall point is that after the informal Wuhan summit, the India-China ties have somehow improved. That's what the Chinese President here tries to convey. Now if you look at this Bangladesh-China-India-Myanmar corridor, the length is around 2,800 kilometers. Now this idea was conceived in 1990s, but formally announced or endorsed in the year 2013 only. So you see how long it takes for an initiative to take action. Now BCIM stands for Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar corridor. Now in this project, the city of Kunming, which is located in Yunnan province of China, will be connected with the Kolkata city in India.
this corridor would pass through Myanmar and Bangladesh. That is in Mandalay in Myanmar and Dhaka in Bangladesh. So all the four countries of this BCIM corridor will be benefited with a network of modern connectivity. And this also includes developing rail connectivity, road connectivity, port connectivity, communication and also trade connectivity. These are all the advantages of this corridor. Now the Chinese president has also stressed that the two sides, India and China, should follow or abide by the basic judgment that India and China are the opportunities for development and they are not threat to each other. So both India and China should push to deepen the mutual trust and to focus on cooperation, at the same time also accepting the differences of the respective sides. So all these actions will make the China-India, India-China relations a more positive asset and a positive energy to promote the development of two countries. And the news article also talks about the bilateral meeting with Russia as well. So Indian Prime Minister held talks with Russian President yesterday. So in the meeting, Russian President invited Indian Prime Minister to take part in Vladivostok Forum that is to happen in September this year. So this Vladivostok Forum is also called as Eastern Economic Forum. Now this was established by a decree of the President of Russian Federation, Mr. Vladimir Putin, in the year 2015. So these are very recent initiatives. Now, if you look at the objectives of this forum, two objectives correspond to a particular region in Russia. And that region is nothing but Russian Far East, right? The Far Eastern region of entire Russian territory. So the objectives of this Eastern Economic Forum includes strengthening the ties between international investment community, Russian business and federal, regional and local government bodies of Russia. And also to conduct a comprehensive expert assessment of the economic potential of Russian Far Eastern region and to improve the region's competitiveness, attractiveness to investors at the national and international level. Here when we say national level, it means the level of Russian country. So India's participation in this forum would be a good opportunity to explore Russia's Far Eastern region, that is to explore the economic potential of Russia's Far Eastern region, whether India can get, you know, sizable benefit because of the involvement. So all these initiatives you could cite in your mains answers when you are needed to answer with respect to India-China relations or India-Russia relations. So with this, let's move on to next news article. This article is about using face veil because certain liberals who call themselves as liberals and they say that women wear face veil by exercising free will. Now this article will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national and international importance and under rights issues in Indian polity and governance. In mains, it could come under GS paper 1. Role of women, their problems and remedies. Now the author talks about exercising free will in order to justify socially forced traditions or socially forced customs. The author uses the word coercion, which means forced. Now here we are discussing about the social tradition of using a face veil. A face veil is nothing but a clothing that covers the face. Recently, after the terrorist attack in Sri Lanka, the Sri Lankan government has imposed a ban on covering the face of both men and women. A similar ban is also there in France as well. So for the reason given in Sri Lanka is security, but the author here supports the ban of using face veil because it liberates women from social coercion. Now here the author is literally meaning the use of face veil in Islam or wherever such a practice is there. Now the practice of covering face by clothing, and we could see this exists only for women. That makes this practice discriminatory. We do not find men being forced to use face veil. But women are made to wear, or women are made to cover their face. This tradition of covering face is being forced by the society, saying it as, you know, it is tradition, it is custom, it is God ordained, or it is based on religion, etc. Now, such women were psychologically trained or tuned by patriarchal world to believe that covering face is very important or vital for a woman, or a woman or a choice with respect to covering face by a woman cannot be her own choice. Or in other words, a woman cannot have a choice other than covering her face. The author says that such imposition is given mostly to the population of lower status. The author says in a patriarchal setup, women are in lower status. For highlighting the word lower, the author has used subaltern. So in a patriarchal setup, women are potential victims. The women are made to believe that way. This made to believe women or men, they say that they are using the face veil to cover the face only by the fullest application of mind, and it is their own decision. In other words, we can say this is free will. They say by free will they use face veil. The author talks about certain traditions, customs that are illogically defended as being exercised by free will. One such example the author talks about with respect to Hindu religion is sati, or the practice of sati. Among certain Hindu communities, after the death of a married man, now the dead body of the man will be burnt. In other words, called as cremated. The wife of the man has to fall into the fire of the dead husband and has to die along. Now this is the simple meaning of what is sati. If you see historically, traditionally, culturally, this practice of woman falling into the fire of dead husband and to die is only for women. This practice was socially forced only for female spouse. And this discriminatory sati was also defended by many as, you know, women die with the dead body of their husband by free will. And very recently in independent India, in the year 1987, a girl around 17 or 18 year old has committed this practice of sati. Her name is Roop Kunwar. And immediately in the same year, the central government has enacted the Commission of Sati Prevention Act, 1987. The author says that in most of the cases, we could see people using the option of free will to defend such customs or traditions. And they call themselves as liberals. Author says that all those people who use free will to defend sati or such socially forced customs are not liberals, because they are not applying liberalism in the true sense or in the right sense, and therefore they need to rethink. And therefore this title of the article is Liberals Need to Think Again. The author is actually generous in giving examples in various religions. Next illogical and socially forced custom he gives from Christianity. The author says that they say that marriage is made in heaven. The socially forced interpretation of this is that the woman who is part of this marriage that is made in heaven should not leave the marriage, however bad or abusive her husband could be. But now tradition in Christianity is having no single supporter in Europe, says the author. And then the author talks about slavery. He says it is the hugely exploited branch of humanity. He says that, you know, yes, male slave owners have justified it. Even the slaves themselves have at times justified slavery as the best of all choices. Even when the slave says such, no, one cannot adhere to such statement, which he may justify by saying that he exercised free will. Now, the problem is that when such norms are forced socially or religiously or in community, those who follow such customs or traditions are given prestige or respect or acceptable in their community. And these women have no other option, or they were given no other option. So in the absence of options, there is only one way a woman is forced to go. So the author says that there should be other options, and the other options should have equivalent prestige and acceptability. This equivalent prestige and acceptability should be there not only within the community, but also such respect and acceptability, which is for other options, should be there outside the community also. So the author states that for a choice that is made to be called, you know, made based on free will, there should be various other options. And these options need to have equivalent prestige and acceptability both within the community and around it. Only then we can say that the application of a certain practice or a custom is based on a free will. Therefore, the author calls to those people who say that, you know, the use of face veil is based on free will, should not call themselves as liberals, and to call themselves as liberals, they have to rethink. With this, we come to the end of this news article. Now, this news article is about drop or decrease in infant mortality rate in the state of Tamil Nadu. Now, this news article will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and demographics in social development. So, the information that we are going to see here can be utilized in mains answer writing with respect to healthcare. So, this will be also be relevant in GS paper 2 under issues relating to development and management of social sector or social services relating to health. Now, the news article states that infant mortality rate drops in the state of Tamil Nadu, and they have also given some key reasons or some important reasons for achieving reduction in infant mortality rate. The news also talks about IMR at the All India level. And if you see in last paragraph, we could find a word called as neonatal death. We'll see that in detail later. So when you are studying about mortality rates or whatever you study, you try to relate it with any goal or target under sustainable development goals. And yes, of course, you need to keep all the terms, all the targets, all the goals that are given under sustainable development goals, because these goals and targets by and large will not change until 2030. So you can better remember all those things. So now we shall also seeing about some SDG goals with respect to this IMR. First, we should know what is infant mortality rate. See, in medical definitions, infant means those children who are under the age of 1. So infant mortality rate means, mortality means death. So it means number of infant deaths recorded under the age of 1 for every 1,000 live births. So according to WHO, World Health Organization, at the world level, the IMR has decreased from 65 deaths per 1,000 live births in 1990 to 29 deaths per 1,000 live births in 2017. So in terms of numbers, the annual infant deaths have declined from about 88 lakh all over the world in 1990 to around 41 lakh in 2017. As per Niti Aayog information from Niti Aayog, India recorded IMR of 68 per 1000 live births in 2000. See, in 2000 it was 68. But within 16 years, that is in 2016, we reached IMR to 34 deaths per 1000 live births. So we can clearly see that there is a 50% reduction in IMR rate with these 16 years. So in 2017, it even dropped by one more point to reach 33 deaths per 1000 live births. And to compare among the states, for the year 2016, Goa was the best performer, which has, you know, the lowest infant mortality rate in India. It has recorded just 8 deaths per 1000 live births in 2016. Now, the next best or the second best is the state of Kerala. It recorded IMR of 10. Tamil Nadu is around 6th best among the states. Now, we have said the state of Tamil Nadu because the news article is with respect to Tamil Nadu. And the state of Tamil Nadu has recorded IMR rate of 17 in 2016. Now, this news states that it has further reduced this IMR by one more point so as to reach 16 in the year 2017. Since 2013, if you see, the IMR rates of Tamil Nadu have seen a steady decline. And if you see this table, the rates are declining by at least one point every year since 2013. We will see what are the reasons for achieving, you know, this drop in infant mortality rate in Tamil Nadu. Before that, we will see some of the sustainable development goals and targets related to the present discussion. Now, this article is concerned with health and well-being of the children. So it will come under SDG goal number 3. So it's about health. So ensuring healthy lives and promoting well-being of all at all ages. So if you hear, if you see target number 3.2, it states that by the year 2030, the world needs to end preventable deaths of newborns and children under the 5 years of age. So we know that Millennium Development Goals targeted reduction. Sustainable Development Goals target elimination of problems. So Millennium Development Goals or MDGs targeted reduction, whereas the goals of SDGs are absolute in nature. It talks about eliminating poverty, not reduction, eliminating. So here also it states that the goal number 3.2 states by 2030, the world needs to end preventable deaths of newborns and children under 5 years of age. And one specific target is that all the countries should have the aim to reduce neonatal mortality to at least as low as 12 per 1,000 live births. And the countries should also reduce the under 5 mortality to at least as low as 25 per 1,000 live births. Now, in general parlance, if you see, the under 5 mortality is called as child mortality rate. Now, there are two terms. One is neonatal mortality or neonatal deaths, neonatal death rate, and the other is under 5 mortality rate. According to WHO, neonatal period means the first 28 days of life of a child after birth. Now, this is the most vulnerable time of a child's survival. So, providing proper health care is very necessary and it will prevent from the death of the child in that period. Now, this neonatal mortality rate means number of neonatal deaths per 1,000 live births. And under 5 mortality rate is very easy to explain. See, the number of deaths of children who are under 5 years of age per 1,000 live births. Now, for India, the child mortality rate or under 5 mortality rate is 39 in 2016, whereas neonatal mortality rate is 24 in 2016. Now, you need to know the basic definitions of, infant mortality rate, neonatal mortality rate, maternal mortality rate, child mortality rate, so as to learn this from the examination point of view. Now we'll see the reasons for the achievement in the state of Tamil Nadu, particular relevance to this infant mortality rate. Now in the state, there have been special newborn care units. Many number of them have been set up, and this is cited as one of the reason, as it was very helpful in reducing the neonatal deaths of children. Now the next reason they cite is the screening of congenital heart diseases. Now this screening has made early diagnosis and early treatment of neonatal children as possible one. And these screenings have been made possible through a national level government scheme called as Rastriya Bal Swasthya Karyakram. Here Rastriya means national. So whenever you see some program with the word Rastriya, it means it's not a state level program, it's a national level program. Bal means children. Swasthya means healthy or, well-being. And Karyakram means program. So, Rastriya Bal Swasthya Karyakram means national health program for children, or we can also say that as national well-being program for children. So, knowing these words and the meaning will help to get a rough idea about the program, or you can at least narrow down your options. Now, this program or this Karyakram was launched in 2013 under National Rural Health Mission. Now, the initiative is having an aim to screen and manage children from birth till 18 years of age. If you see the legal definition of child, for example, if you take Juvenile Justice Act, it will say that the child means those who has not completed 18 years of age. But here in medical parlance, when you say child mortality rate, it means under 5 mortality rate. Now, these differences you keep in mind. Now, the initiative aims to screen and manage children from birth till 18 years of age. Children will be screened for, defects at birth, deficiencies, diseases, developmental delays, and also disabilities. It's being implemented by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Now, another reason is that that help for reducing this IMR in Tamil Nadu is because of improvement in healthcare services in the state. The state has improved the comprehensive emergency obstetric and newborn care services. Obstetrics is the branch of medicine and surgery that is concerned with childbirth. So having, you know, improved emergency response with respect to these care services has helped the state in reducing the IMR. Now, the achievement was also made possible because of regular home visits that are made by the health, that is village health nurses and Anganwadi workers. And they have played a very important role in achieving this reduction in IMR. Now let us move on to next news article. Now the displayed practice prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Now this news article is about rainwater harvesting. Now this article will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and in general issues in environmental ecology. And from mains perspective, in GS paper 3 in the area conservation, if you know, particularly under water conservation. Now you may think this is a regional news article, but it is important because the crux of the article is about rainwater harvesting. We know that many states in our country are facing water crisis in the way of water scarcity or shortage of water. Niti Aayog in the month of June 2018, in one of the report while publishing composite water management index, it has stated that India is facing worst water crisis in the history. And you might have seen various news articles relating to water crisis in the states of Tamil Nadu, Punjab, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, especially during the starting of or the beginning of summer season. We know that the groundwater levels in many states are depleting and are in a worrying state. So even at a national level, this issue of water conservation, particularly from rainwater, is very important to address the water crisis. So in mains examination, if any question is relating to management of water crisis is asked, you shall mention about rainwater harvesting as it is one of the conservation method. So it is a nationwide problem. Now the article mentions that a particular residential complex in Chennai was very well in managing the water crisis in the city. They were able to manage this crisis because there was availability of groundwater. When the entire city is stumbling on water crisis because of the shortage in groundwater level, how the residential complex has the availability of groundwater? Now, the article states that this is because the apartment had better rainwater harvesting techniques. Now, majority of buildings in Chennai city have rainwater harvesting structures. This is because in 2003, through an ordinance, Tamil Nadu made rainwater harvesting mandatory for all buildings, both private and public in the state. Now, this movement within the state was started in the year 2001 as part of rainwater harvesting scheme. Now, the ordinance is called as Tamil Nadu Municipal Laws Ordinance of 2003. So, under this ordinance, it was mandatory for the Metropolitan Development Authority of Chennai City and municipal corporations others to sanction the building plans only if the plans contain rainwater harvesting structures. We will discuss about rainwater harvesting structures. And if a plan does not have, if a building does not have rainwater harvesting structures, then there were provisions so that water and sewer connections would not be given to such buildings. And rainwater harvesting has been made mandatory also in three-storied buildings, irrespective of the size of rooftop area. Now, the provision mentions irrespective of the size of rooftop area. Now, this is important because there will be some buildings, they may say our rooftop area is very small and therefore we cannot harness or tap the rainwater and therefore we cannot have rainwater harvesting structure. So, buildings should not escape saying such stories. Therefore, they have made mandatory that in all three-storied buildings also, irrespective of size of rooftop area, it is necessary. So, if you take most of the states, maybe other than one or two states, most of the states will be having amendments in municipal laws, district municipal laws. In their local municipal laws, there will be amendment so as to have this rainwater harvesting structure in buildings. Now, let's come to some data regarding the Now, for example, if you take Chennai city and according to Chennai Metro Water Organization, there is nearly 8.9 lakh rainwater harvesting structures in various buildings across the city. Now, this will be the case with various cities in the country. Now, where will be the problem is coming, Now, the problem will come when there is no enough data regarding the maintenance of the structures. Because in Chennai, there is no data available about the maintenance of these 8.9 lakh rainwater harvesting structures. It is stated that only random checks are carried out, and one non-governmental organization called as Rain Center carries out rainwater harvesting audit in suburban areas. And it is important to tap the rainwater in the month of June, because we know in the month of June, national level, we have this southwest monsoon. And also because the rainwater structures would be absolutely efficient during this period of summer season, as dry land would absorb more water. And several people are now shifting to recharge wells because of growing awareness on rainwater harvesting. See, this rainwater harvesting is a process of collecting, then conveying or transferring, and also storing the rainfall in a particular area for beneficial purposes. Now, the collected rainwater can either be stored or it can be used for recharging the groundwater. Now, the rainwater collection can be done using, you know, from rooftops, directly from land surface, catchments or watersheds, etc. The rainwater harvesting methods basically classified into two types. One, surface runoff harvesting. That is nothing but during a heavy downpour, water flows in the surface. That is called a surface runoff. This runoff water can be collected and used for recharging aquifers. Next method is rooftop harvesting. See, in this system, the roof of a building becomes the catchment area. Now, catchment or catchment area is the area or surface that receives the rainfall. So, the rainfall, rainwater can be collected from the roof of the house. Now, this we can see in the picture. The collected water can either be stored for using, you know, for various purposes, or it can be diverted to artificial recharge system. We may see about, you know, some of the main components of a rooftop rainwater harvesting system. Now, it requires a catchment from where water is captured and stored or recharged. It also requires gutters or drains and some downtake pipes. Now, these are conveyance system, part of conveyance system, because they carry the water that is harvested from the catchment to the storage or recharge zone. Then we require filters and first flush devices. Now, first flush is used to flush out the first spell of rain. Now, these devices remove sand, leaves and dirt, which are often found in the first rains. It's necessary to remove these from the rainwater collected from the first rain, because it may contaminate the whole water that is available in the storage tank. See, these devices are helpful whenever rain occur after a long time, because we used to hear from our parents that they won't ask us to, you know, take bath during the first rain in a year. Or whenever it rains after a long period, parents advise their children not to take bath in the rain, because the rainwater in the rain will have a lot of pollutants that is dissolved in rainwater. And so if you take these filters and first flush devices, they divert the water from the first rain to avoid mixing of it with this water of storage tank. Then storage tanks. See, these tanks could be either above ground or underground or partly underground. The tanks may be covered so that water will be clean. Now, before using the tank, as usual, it has to be thoroughly cleaned and disinfected. Now, disinfection can be carried out using chlorine, bleaching powder, potassium permanganate. Now, then delivery systems. Now, these should be, you know, efficient piping system that can deliver the stored water for the final use or end use. Then recharge structures. Now, the harvested rainwater can also be used for recharging the groundwater aquifers. Now, this can be done through construction of various kinds of, structures such as dug wells, bore wells, recharge trenches, recharge pits, similarly as you see in this picture. Now, it could be in different depths, because there should be enough depth so that the harvested water reaches the lower soil strata. And one important thing is that these recharge structures should be desilted from time to time. Now, silt is a fine deposit which keep on sedimenting in these structures and obstructs the charging of groundwater. We are giving this information to get a wholesome knowledge, right? Now, why this rainwater harvesting is necessary? See, our country already faces several problems such as severe water scarcity, pollution in existing surface water bodies, and floods come during rainy seasons. In some way, for all these problems, rainwater harvesting is a solution. And the methods involved in rainwater harvesting are also simple. They could be easily maintained at a minimal cost. And India is a right place, you know, to have these rainwater harvesting structures, as it is very much possible because India has a good potential for harvesting the rain. And more importantly, because of tropical monsoon or tropical southwest monsoon. Now, this is important because these rains from the monsoon are sufficient to cater or to serve the need of the people. And on the side of people, what we require is the judicious use of rainwater. Now, coming to the advantages of rainwater harvesting, first, it improves the water usage practices. Now, the rainwater harvesting is a perfect solution or an ideal solution in areas where there is inadequate water, groundwater supply, or insufficient surface water resources. Now, India is facing a depletion of groundwater resources because of various reasons such as excessive pumping of water, and we also see inconsistent rainfall or non-uniform rainfall across the country. And also because of pollution of groundwater, the water becomes unusable. Now, how the groundwater is polluted? Now, this is because of the leaks from waste dumping sites. So, replenishment of groundwater resources is necessary. In this way, in this area, rainwater harvesting is important. Now, according to Central Pollution Control Board, rainwater is bacteriologically pure. That is, it has no bacteria. And it is free from organic matter and it is soft in nature. Now, soft water means the water that has minimal total dissolved solids. In other words, the water that is free from dissolved salts of metals such as calcium, iron or magnesium. This is the general definition. There is also technical definition. Now, the rainwater harvesting will also help in reducing flood hazard. Now, see, because now excess water is collected rather than going as surface runoff, the excess water is now recharged and collected. So, there will be reducing of flood hazard. Now, it also improves the quality of existing groundwater and it helps to replenish it. It will also reduce the cost of pumping of groundwater. See, by recharge of groundwater, the groundwater table increases. The level of availability of groundwater increases. So, now what will happen? It will reduce the effort for pumping deep. If the water table level is lower, then it requires pumping of groundwater from deep depth. That means cost of pumping is more. So, rainwater harvesting reduces the cost of pumping. No land gets wasted for rainwater harvesting and there is no issue of population displacement. Now, this means when a city or an area is properly conserving rainwater by rainwater harvesting structures, so that the groundwater level will be at a higher level. So, there may not be requirement for water storage capacities such as dams. So, there will be no need for storage dams. That means there is no requirement of construction of dams. There is no requirement of displacing people from one area to another for construction of dams. No need for land acquisition. No need for relief and rehabilitation. See, the rainwater can be one of the positive with respect to rainwater is it can be tapped at any place where it rains and it can be utilized at the time of need. One of the most important advantage with respect to the rainwater harvesting structures are that they are simple, less costly or economical and also eco-friendly. Thus, it helps in utilizing the primary source of water, that is the rainwater, and it prevents the surface runoff from going into sewer or storm drains. And thus, it also reduces the unnecessary burden on treatment plants to provide usable water because already we will have usable water because of rainwater harvesting. If we look for statutory backing for rainwater harvesting or legislations for rainwater harvesting, different states have different legislations. These legal provisions you could find in most of the legislations or with respect to local area or within the state jurisdiction in the Municipalities Act of the particular state. So with this, we come to the end of this article discussion. The displayed practice mains question will be discussed in the last session. Next, we'll be seeing three news articles related to India-United States trade relations. If you see, the three news articles have a common thread or a link. The three news articles are based on speeches delivered by three individuals at the India Ideas Summit of United States India Business Council. This summit was held in Washington, United States, Washington, D.C., United States. The first news article is about the with respect to the speech of United States Secretary of State. The second one is with respect to the speech of Commerce Secretary of United States. Third is with respect to the CEO of Google. These articles will be relevant in mains preparation in GS paper 2 under bilateral groupings and agreements involving India and or affecting India's interests. Effect of policies and politics of developed countries on India's interests, and in GS 3 under Indian economy and issues relating to growth and development. And even in prelim syllabus, it could come under current events of national and international importance. The first news article deals with Secretary of State of US. It largely deals with the current present trade tensions between India and United States, particularly with reference to the GSP status of beneficiary to India. See, generalized system of preferences is a scheme of developed nations like United States to provide preferential access to certain goods of developing countries like India. We have been seeing that till May that whether United States will revoke the GSP status, the GSP beneficiary status given to India. And on June 5, 2019, the US president has revoked the beneficiary status of India or the beneficiary status to India under the GSP program. He told that India had not provided adequate or enough assurances to the United States on equitable and reasonable market access to its companies. The US Secretary of State hints that it is possible to reinstate the GSP beneficiary status to India, and it is expected that by the end of this weekend or in the coming days, as soon as possible within this month, the US Secretary of State has scheduled a visit to India, and he will be most probably discussing about GSP issue and also with respect to 5G network technology and data localization with Indian counterparts. And through him, the United States has expressed willingness to hold dialogues, and it expects that India will drop the trade barriers to US companies. Now, some of the problems between the two countries, other than or in addition to GSP, is the data localization regulations and proposed policies with respect to e-commerce. And with respect to e-commerce, some implemented policies or some changes in the e-commerce policy with respect to foreign direct investments are already been made in our country. Those are also some of the tensions between India and United States. The US Secretary of State has stated that US will push for free flow of data of Indians across borders, and in addition to helping American companies, it will also provide protection of data and securing consumers' privacy. So that is, the United States wants the data of all Indians with respect to, you know, it could be financial data or any other data, that it wants these data to be stored in US also. But the stand of Indian government is that Indian data should be stored only within the territory of India. That is what we call data localization. And US is not happy with respect to the stand of India, as it wants Indian data should freely flow across borders. And he also expressed that US is ready to help India establish secure communication networks, including 5G networks. Here, the United States doesn't want the Chinese company to take part in the trials of 5G network in India. So US want its companies or its counterparts to take care of or establishing communications in 5G networks in our country. US administration, along with its allies or partner countries, trying to block the Chinese telecom giant Huawei from participating in building their 5G telecommunication network in our country. And in addition, US has also put Hawaii on a trade blacklist as well. Now let us see the second news article. Now this article is with respect to the speech delivered by Commerce Secretary of United States. He is telling that the GSP beneficiary status was removed for India because India has failed to address the trade related concerns of United States, which was raised by him during his visit to our country in May 2019. Now, he has mentioned some points to project or to portray or compare United States level of trade protection with respect to India. And US says that it is the least protectionist among major countries, and US has trade deficit to prove this fact. And it is told that US has zero tariffs on 61% of the total value of United States total import. India's average tariff rates are at 13.8% at the stage of import, and the Commerce Secretary of US tells that these tariff rates of India are the highest of any major world economy. And the accusation is that India has higher tariff rates for importing automobiles, alcoholic beverages, motorcycles from United States. And there were issues between India and the Harley-Davidson company in United States because of these higher tariff rates. And to support his point, he also added that United States is India's largest export destination, but India remained only at the 13th position. That is, India is the 13th largest export market of United States. So though India has a large population, US has a trade deficit with India, and that is mainly because of overly restrictive market access barriers by the government of India. So these are the stand taken by the Commerce Secretary of United States. Now these are their representations. Now let us come to the third news article. Now this article is with respect to the speech given by CEO of Google company. He notes that India and United States share values in common to lead on standardizing privacy frameworks. And according to him, if standardization of privacy frameworks is done across the world, it could significantly enhance digital trade all over the world. And these standardized frameworks has to be created for both users and companies. And he adds that users will have the choice and total transparency, and companies must have to be accountable. But we know it is very difficult to make the private companies accountable for such frameworks. And to convince India that India should partner with the United States in having shared values with respect to privacy frameworks, Google CEO used two important points. One, India and US have reasonably aligned notions with respect to free and open internet, and both the countries have safeguarded principles of free expression, right? These two points used by the CEO to propose that both the countries with this background should also have enough shared values to lead in privacy frameworks as well. Now let's see about this US-India Business Council. See, this council aims to create an inclusive bilateral trade environment between India and the United States. The council will also serve as voice of the industry to link governments to businesses, and also by supporting long-term commercial business related partnerships. It's also stated that the activities of this council will develop a spirit of entrepreneurship, you know, create jobs in both the economies, and also successfully contribute to the global economy also. This is what the written objectives, but the main objective is that to develop trade between United States and India so as to, you know, mutually help each other in developing their business industry. With this, we come to the end of this news article. Now let us move on to our final session, practice come revision session. Now this question, they have given two statements. They are asking which of the above statements is or are correct. The first statement, neonatal mortality rate means number of deaths of children for the first 28 days of life per 1,000 live births. So we saw that today, according to WHO, This is the exact definition of neonatal mortality rate. Therefore, the first statement is correct. And this period is the most important time for a child's survival, as it is the most vulnerable period for a child's survival, because it requires highly efficient and proper health care for the child during that time. Now, the second statement, Sustainable Development Goal Target 3.2 aims to reduce neonatal mortality rate to at least as low as 12 per 1,000 live births. We know that Sustainable Development Goal 3 deals with health and well-being. So, and today we saw that Target 3.2 asks all countries to aim to reduce this neonatal mortality to at least as low as 12 per 1,000 live births. So this statement is also correct. So the correct answer for this question is option C, both 1 and 2. The next question is, in GS3, what is rainwater harvesting? Examine its role in conservation of water. Previous year's GS3 question paper, you can find two questions in a similar fashion, one with respect to wetlands and the other with respect to minimum support price. So here in this question, you can say that the rainwater harvesting is the process of collection, transfer and storage of rainwater through rainwater harvesting structures and the usage of the collected water for various purposes. And its role is that it can be adopted anywhere there is rainfall. Particularly, it is highly helpful in tropical countries that are blessed with tropical monsoon, such as India, where we have southwest monsoon. And the collected water can be used for various purposes. And two, the collected water prevents surface runoff to drains. Thereby, there is no need for the collected water can be used in the location where it is required for various purposes. In the same location, it can be helpful in recharging of groundwater. Thereby, it elevates or, you know, increases the groundwater table level. And thus, it prevents the need of recycling or purifying at the municipality level so as to provide usable water to houses. And rainwater harvesting actually conserves water from the primary source of water, that is rainfall. And this rainwater we saw, according to Central Pollution Control Board, the rainwater is free from bacteria, free from organic matter. And this method of rainwater harvesting is simple, can be maintained at minimal cost, economical, easy to adopt. So all these methods will help large masses of people to adapt to this style of water conservation. So these are some of the points that you could use from today's discussion to highlight your answer for this question. With this, we come to the end of today's discussion. If you like the video, press the like button, share it with your friends, comment, and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates on news analysis.